tonight, all you have to do is swing.
All right.
It hurts me to think all you got to do is sing.
Hello, and today we will come back on the very recent GPHG ceremony celebrating the best timepieces of 2018. And I have to say it was a nice addition, and this for a number of reasons I will develop. So first of all, and as a quick reminder, this award does not reflect all the watches that came out during the year. I mean, it's up to the brand to present the watches they feel could win in the various 12 categories, but this nevertheless leaves us with a pretty nice and large selection. In terms of categories and changes, well, this year saw the introduction of a new lower-priced watch category, one up to 4,000 Swiss francs, and the Petite Aiguille now being set between 4,000 and 10,000 Swiss francs. So kind of a way to say that we think about the general public, the normal consumer, well, kind of, because one has to acknowledge that the average mean prices of the watches participating in this GPHG is quite stratospheric. But again, the goal is to award the very best, and often this comes at a certain price tag. But I will come back on some general appreciation of the Grand Prix at the end of this video, just some extra food for thoughts. Anyhow, let's immediately talk about the absolute winner of this year's edition, meaning the winner of the Aiguille d'Or, the Golden Hand. And I was very happy that this prize went for Bovet and their spectacular Recital 22, Grand Recital, which we covered here on the Watches TV. I mean, this prize celebrates commitment, passion, and perseverance. And you know my feeling towards Bovet, so really delighted for the team and Mr. Raffi. Let's quickly hear a word by the man himself, a happy man.
I'm feeling so honored on behalf of my extended family. This is the reward. Absolutely transparently speaking about integrity, morality towards the collectors, and a deep love for a community of artisans which are absolutely genius people. Like two hands to applaud, you need both of them. And you are in the middle, the captain, to have a vision. But without them, you will never do anything. So I'm honored for them and delighted for my children, my family, and it's very touching, absolutely touching.
So yes, perseverance pays, as the Grand Recital R22 Flying Tourbillon Perpetual Calendar is the third member of this Recital collection. We had previously seen the R18 Shooting Star, then the R20 Asterium. And this Aiguille d'Or really reflects a much deserved award for a brand which always impressed me in terms of the quality of their timepieces, their technicity, creativity, without forgetting, of course, the no-compromise side of the finishing of these timepieces. I must say that over the years, I've had the great chance of filming pretty up close some of their timepieces, and they are always impeccable, as simple as that. Well, if you want to know more about this winning timepiece, I clearly invite you to check the video report we had done at the time, so link below, because it's most definitely a very dense piece of machinery. Think of the moon rotating around the Earth in a perfect lunar cycle of 29.5 days, but with the visible side of the moon always facing the sun, represented by the tourbillon, yes. So little things that make all the difference. Okay, let's continue, but before jumping to the results per category, there were a few other distinctions awarded during the ceremony, which also made me rather happy, such as the special prize of the jury, handed to Mr. Jean-Claude Biver for his lifelong role, achievement, and career, how he impacted watchmaking as we know it today, and going by the standing ovation he received from the entire industry, well, this is for sure something people are very respectful of. So it was a moving moment, and one could feel that Mr. Beaver was sincerely very touched by this recognition.
44 ans, et ce soir, peut-être la plus belle émotion. Une passion ne peut pas se mettre à la retraite. Un job, on peut prendre la retraite d'un travail, mais jamais la retraite d'une passion. Maintenant, je ne suis que le dépositaire de ce prix. Parce que ce prix, jamais je ne l'aurais reçu sans ma garde rapprochée. Alors à tous ces gens qui travaillent avec moi, merci. Le prix est à vous.
And for me, what makes it even more special is that on that very same day of the GPHG, we spent a few hours with Mr. Beaver at his beautiful private home for a 2-hour long interview retracing his career and his views on today's watchmaking. So can't wait to share this with you very soon. And you got it, it's long, but interesting, inspiring, honest, transparent, full of anecdotes. And again, Mr. Jean-Claude Beaver is seriously part of this small club of men, fully deserving their place in this Hall of Fame of watchmaking I've been mentioning a few times. Okay, but the good stuff didn't stop there, as another special prize was handed to Mr. Konstantin Chaykin, that's the Russian watchmaker I like a lot for his creative and fresh take on watchmaking. And he was very rightfully awarded an Audacity Prize, and this reflects perfectly my appreciation of the man. Audacity and outside-the-box thinking and doing. And the good news with this is that we will also very shortly publish a report on the man and his Moscow setup, as we were there only a little while ago, and you will discover something pretty different and original. Couldn't dream of a better teaser than this prize to announce this video coming soon. In terms of other special prizes, a revival prize went to Vacheron Constantin for its historique Triple Calendrier 1942, a very nice watch, classical and elegant. And another innovation prize went for Crayon for a very special and complicated watch which lets you see every sunrise and sunset times depending on where you stand on this planet. So a real complex engineering feat, and I hope we'll be able to show you this more in detail soon. Totally worth it. Okay, let's now talk about the different categories, and I just wanted to remind that many watchers are actually entered into each category, but then a special jury makes a first selection of 6 pre-qualified watches, and it is this last selection which will ultimately be judged by the jury at large. So 12 categories, 6 watches per category, so a total of 72 watches on the menu of this 2018 GPHG ceremony. And let's start with the challenge prize, meaning watches priced below 4,000. And I was pleased for Nomos, who won with their Tangante Neomatic Update 41 piece, a super decently priced watch when you consider the fact that it holds the brand's own in-house manufactured movement with this minimalistic but distinct design features and this simple yet original way of displaying the date. So going slightly up the ladder in terms of prizes, the Petite Aiguille, awarding watches up to 10,000 Swiss francs, went to the Austrian brand Habring 2. So this sweet couple have already won the prizes on 3 previous occasions, but what can be said about this double Felix? A split-second chronograph, one of my favorite complications, priced just under 9,000 Swiss francs. Isn't that just quite crazy? So Habring 2 is for sure a very interesting brand, only 5 employees and some pretty technical watches and a lot of watchmaking know-how there. So we definitely need to go and visit them. It has to be done. In the sport category, the award went to Seiko with the Prospect 1968 Divers Recreation, a watch celebrating the 50 years of the original model, which housed the brand's first high beat movement at the time. So this is a limited edition of 1500 pieces, and I know it's pretty hard to get, so this award won't make it any easier. In the chronograph category, the award went to Singer Reimagine with the Singer Track 1 Hong Kong edition, a watch in which you will find the amazing Agenograph movement from Agenor, something that obviously made me happy, and it was very sport of Mr. Marco Boracino, co-founder of the brand, to share the honor with Nicolas Widerrecht and the cool team of Agenor. When it comes to the men's watch category, this was also really cool and fresh, as Acrivia won with their Chronomètre Contemporain. This is a young brand developed by a young and talented watchmaker, Recep Recepi. His name is found on the dial of this special watch, and I'm pretty sure we will hear about them rather soon on the Watches TV, and this for a very simple reason. Yes, we are literally neighbors here in the old town of Geneva, and I am very happy for them. That's a nice recognition. Okay, next prize, and let's talk about a slightly revised category, as this one used to be dedicated to tourbillons only, but now has been called the chronometric category, meaning that brands can enter with a non-tourbillon, but nevertheless complex mechanisms. But to be honest, 5 out of 6 of the nominated watch were tourbillons, and the cool thing is that it's De Béthune who won with their absolutely gorgeous DB25 Stradivarius Chronometre, a timepiece where you actually can't see the tourbillon from the dial side. Very chic for sure. So In general, I'm very happy for the Béthune, who went through some pretty difficult times in the recent years, not far from going bust, but since the new takeover, things are looking to go in the right direction. They have always come up with incredible timepieces, but now it really seems that management is following a much sounder path. Bravo to them! Next category is the Mechanical Exception Prize for some crazy developments, and this award went to Greubel Forcé for their astounding Grande Sonnerie. A timepiece 11 years in the making, and what a timepiece. I mean, the Grande Sonnerie represents the holy grail of any serious watchmaker, and I have had the great privilege of holding and enjoying this marvel, and simply what an achievement from the Greubel Forcé team. I mean, this timepiece chimes beautifully, the sound is round and so close to perfection, and as a quick reminder, a Grande Sonnerie is a timepiece which chimes on the passing of each quarter, but then you can at any time use it as a minute repeater and ask the time on demand too. So it's a super complex movement from the totally dedicated and uncompromising team of Greubel Forcé, rewarded by the jury. We'll stay in the world of complicated watches for the next category, the Man Complication category, and this went to Laurent Ferrier and its Galet Annuel Calendar School Piece. I really like Laurent Ferrier, the brand and the man, and he seemed very happy and proud to have won this prize, his third actually. Next category with the Ladies Complication, and this one went to Van Cleef & Arpels for the really beautiful Lady Arpels Planetarium. On the exterior part of the dial, you have a shooting star trailing indication of the hours, but inside you have three planets, Mercury, Venus, and the Earth, revolving in exact cycles around the Sun at the center. So it not only takes 365 days for the Earth to move around the Sun, but on top of this, you have a Moon revolving in 29.5 days around the Earth. So yes, quite magic, and what a technical development here too, not even talking about the craftsmanship involved. Okay, let's stay with feminine watches, with the ladies' watch. And this one went to Chanel and its boyfriend skeleton timepiece. I mentioned a few weeks ago that Chanel does some really nice watches, and they are very serious about it, relying, for instance, on Romain Gauthier to increase their overall expertise. And I know some people can associate the brand with other luxury accessories, but again, their watchmaking commitment is a true and genuine one. As this winning watch simply exemplifies. I mean, very nice movement architecture and just beautiful proportions. In the jewelry category, the prize went to Van Cleef & Arpels, their second prize of the evening, with the Secret de Coccinelle, the Lovebox Secret, a playful watch, a full demonstration of the brand's gem-setting know-how, really beautiful, and the dial can be hidden with a love bug that slides over it. And just for info, this watch holds the super small hand-wound movement 101 by Jaeger LeCoultre, so still a mechanical watch behind this rather spectacular piece of artisanship. And talking about craftsmanship, let's talk about the last category, the métier d'art category, which went to La Montre Hermès for the Arceau Robe du Soir, with an incredible leather mosaic of no less than 2,200 very small leather squares, very carefully set on the dial. Just imagine the time it takes to juxtapose all this. That's a pretty patient artisan behind this limited to 12 pieces version of the Arceau. Okay, so now you got the entire palmarès of the 2018 Geneva Grand Prix ceremony. I must say that it was really a good edition, not too many surprises though. It was well organized, getting better every year, and again, I really think that this event celebrating the industry is totally justified, even though it doesn't reflect all the watches that came out in the last 12 months. So something interesting to be noted is the number of non-Swiss brands that won, which gives it a more international flavor, that's nice. But also the fact that there weren't that many brands belonging to the big groups of the industry that won. So overall, if you take the total number of watches produced by the various winners, well, you clearly get the feeling that we are only talking about the very top of the pyramid, exceptional watches that in a certain way don't really reflect what the huge part of the industry is all about. So I don't really know how this could be overcome, but they tried a bit with this new challenge category, but I'm sure they could go much further with this, especially if they want the general public to appreciate this Grand Prix. For me, and for the time being, it's more of a kind of a B2B exercise, but again, a justified one. And something super sweet that I also wanted to bring up is that during each GPHG, there is a special prize handed to the best student of the Geneva Watchmaking School for his first years of studies. So last year you had met Besarta, and this year the prize went to another young kid, Christopher Lanz. But what was really nice was that this prize was handed to him by a rather old watchmaker who won an equivalent prize in 1943, and he is currently 97. but for sure still doing strong, and as a symbol, this was really nice and touching. So I hope you enjoyed this. Still think we have to come up with something ourselves, with you guys involved, but that was nice to see everyone during the same event. And more than ever, Viva Watchmaking! Thanks for watching, all the very best, and enjoy.